I just want to give you a heads up, ladies and gentlemen. The introduction to this episode is a little on the long side. So if you do want to skip ahead and jump straight into my interview with the amazing Paddy Considine, then by all means do so. You're going to want to jump to about 10 minutes in to the podcast. That is where my chat with Paddy begins. If, however, you'd like to hear me ramble for 10 minutes, then that is going to begin right now. Well, 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 here we are. Welcome to episode 252 of Life in the Stocks. My name's Matt Stocks. This is my podcast. Thank you very much for tuning in. If you're not already, please do subscribe to the show wherever you get your podcasts, Acast, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, even YouTube. I'm on. There's no visual, but the audio is there if you do like YouTube as a platform. And if you're not already, please do give me a follow on social media at Matt Stocks DJ on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. That way you can keep up to date with all of my creative and personal endeavors. So I've been doing this show. If you're new to this show, just a bit of background real quick before we get into the amazing episode that you're about to hear with my fantastic guest, Paddy Considine. I've been doing the show for around 5.5 years, and after 250 episodes, it just felt like the time was right to switch up the format and try something new to keep it fresh. And ever since I've been doing this show, I've been doing the occasional live Q&A podcast event, and they've always been really special and unique, and they've always hit in a different way. You know, they've always kind of been received in the room differently to, I guess, how you would listen to an interview on your own at a later date on a podcast, just by the nature of it being live. But just the conversation itself and the momentum that the chat takes in that environment is a lot more, I think, vital and transformative and powerful than it is even in person, if it's just the two of you in a room, but especially on Zoom and over the phone, which is what I've been doing so many interviews, you know, that way for so long because of the pandemic. And I guess that was another factor in me wanting to switch things up as well, is you spend 2 years on Zoom and you just want to be in a room with other humans. And for me, going forward, at least for the foreseeable future, live Q&A evening with type events are the way I want to do it. So the very first one that we did in this all new format was the last episode, which I published, episode 251, with Glenn Matlock from the Sex Pistols. And that night was incredible. It was so cool to be in a room full of Sex Pistols fans, you know, people who were there back in the day, have been with Glenn on the whole journey through the Rich Kids and his time with Iggy Pop and all these different projects that he's done. He's now in Blondie playing bass with them. He did the tour with them, and he's also in the studio recording bass parts for their new album. So he's a busy man, is Glenn, with his finger in many pies. He's done loads of great stuff since the Pistols, and we tried to cover the full range of it in the chat. So do go back and have a listen to that one if you haven't already. We did it before the Pistols drama came out, so we don't get too much into that, but we do touch on it, and we do discuss the, you know, the fallout with Mr. John Lydon, who was, of course, if you've been with me for a while listening to this show since I started it back in 2017, you'll know that John Lydon was a very early guest here on Life in the Stocks. He joined me for episode 10, and Paul Cook was on not too long ago as well. So I've had 3 out of the 4 original Pistols on the show. Loads of other great guests as well. So do please go back and have a look who's been on the show if you are just discovering it today through this chat with Paddy. But Glenn was the first one. And then in May, I did this live evening with Paddy. And that just, that night confirmed and cemented that the decision that I made was the right one. And it was such a special night. I want to say a huge thank you to everybody who came out for it. I want to say a big thank you to Terry and the rest of the team at the West Hampstead Arts Club, which is the venue where I did this Q&A with Paddy that you're about to hear. I did the Glenn Matlock one there. And the next one that I have is also there as well in August, on Thursday the 25th. Of August. It's going to be an evening with Thomas Nicholas, who is an actor, a producer, a musician. You'll probably best know him as Kevin Myers in American Pie. He was also in Rookie of the Year. He's been in many, many, many films and TV shows over the years. He's played Walt Disney. He played Martin Scorsese. He also has been in films with some of my all-time favorite actors and heroes, people like Kate Winslet, Michael Madsen, and Mickey Rourke. So there's lots to talk about on the movie front. And then he's also a musician and a songwriter and a touring artist as well, and he'll be in the UK performing some live shows around that Q&A. And he just put out on Friday of last week a brand new song, which is it's like a parody cover of the Bowling for Soup song 1985, which was a big hit for them. And it's called 1999, and he's changed all the lyrics to make the song about American Pie. And Jarrett from Bowling for Soup, who's another good pal of mine, is also on the song with him. So check that out if that's your thing. That's the next live Q&A event I'll be doing. And I just feel like this is the right format for me, at least with this show going forward. I'm going to relaunch Stoke the Fire with Jesse Leach at the end of July. That will continue to be a regular podcast in the traditional sense of the word over Zoom. Obviously, he's in New York. I'm in England. Our guests are all over the place. So I'd like to do every Stoke the Fire episode as a live show round a campfire, but that at the moment isn't a feasible goal. But with Life in the Stocks, it is. And it just means, the episodes will be less regular. There'll be an episode maybe once a month as opposed to every week. But I think it'll be worth the wait. And this episode right now has been 5 years in the making. Ever since I launched the show, Paddy's been somebody that I wanted to have on. And very early on, we kind of got connected through Instagram. We became friends over the last 5 years. Quite a cool connection and a special friendship between us has developed and evolved. And this just felt like the right time to do it. We've been talking about it for a long time and now felt right. And I want to say a big, big thank you to Paddy, not just for doing the show and taking the time to come down to London and be a part of this event, but I just know that he doesn't do a lot of interviews, especially not live interviews in front of live crowds. That's not really his comfort zone. And so I need to say a big thank you to Paddy for doing it and for wanting to do it and for trusting me to get it right. And he said to me that he had a great night and he thoroughly enjoyed the experience. And that meant a lot. And this evening meant a lot. Everybody who's there will know we were a part of something really special. Paddy, he bared his soul in a very open and honest and personable and intimate way. And it just felt special. And I was like, yeah, doing these things as live events is the way to go. This feels right. This hits differently to a regular, one-on-one interview without the crowd there. And I'm just so proud of what we captured and so pleased with how the event went. So once again, thank you to everybody who came down and was a part of it. Thank you to Paddy. And thank you to his band, Riding the Low, as well. They pieced together an acoustic set, which they'd never done before, and it went so well. They had strings in the mix, and it sounded brilliant. It went over great, and there's something very nice about doing a live interview and then the audience Q&A part of the show, which is how we incorporate, you guys in the crowd into the show, as you'll hear. And then we finish the show with a live performance by the guests. So it's like a three-tiered evening's entertainment, and that music at the end really just ties a ribbon around it and is the cherry on top of a lovely cake, to use two analogies right there. And what I have done though with both the Glenn episode and this one is I've left the music out, partly for rights reasons, but also because I want at least one part of the live show to be just for the people who were there. So you're about to hear the interview and the audience Q&A, but the live music, as was the case with the episode that I shared from my evening with Glenn, the live music stays out, and that's just for the people who were there. And I would suggest, if you're free on the nights that I do these events and you're interested in the guests that I have, please do come along and be a part of it, because they are special. They are, different to a usual show in the traditional sense of the word, but I truly believe in the format. And I'm going to try and get some great guests for future events. So do watch this space. Do come down to a future show if you can. And yeah, all that's left for me to say is check out the new album by Paddy's band, Riding the Low, which is out now. It's called The Death of Gobshite Rambo. It's fantastic. You can also check out, and you should check out, Paddy's son's band. Joseph Hooligan is his handle on Twitter. I'm not sure what the name of his current project is because he's got a lot going on, but recently, I got to be a part of a very special event, which is a night that I'll remember and cherish for a very long time. It was the album launch party for The Death of Gobshite Rambo, Riding the Low's new record, and it was Riding the Low on the bill with support from Paddy's son, Joe's band, and then me DJing. And just to be there with them on that night, on that occasion, was really special. And then to do this live Q&A was just, once again, the icing on the cake. I must have desserts on my mind today. Anyway, enough about my sweet tooth. I hope you enjoy the show. If you do, please do leave a nice rating and review on iTunes. And give me a follow, as I said, if you're not already, on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Matt Stocks DJ. There's lots of good stuff going on. But right now, enjoy this. Episode 252 of Life in the Stocks with actor, writer, director, singer-songwriter, and all-round Renaissance man, Paddy Considine. Enjoy the show.
I struggle to be myself. I'll raise the glass. It's one more night that I won't get home. I'm leaving it up to you. You're calling the shots now.
We're going to go everywhere tonight, ladies and gentlemen. It's a thrill and an honor to be here. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming to the stage my good friend, the main man, Mr. Paddy Considine. Give it up.
Hello. Hello, Matt.
Good to see you, boss.
Just enjoy a sip of this coffee. What is it?
It's a virgin espresso martini.
So, yeah.
So it's basically a ton of coffee. How is it?
It's very strong.
Is it?
It will get me up the M1 after this show.
Yeah, so yeah. Paddy has driven all the way down from Burton on Trent to be here tonight.
You've heard of that place, haven't you?
And I think if it's all right with you, my friend, we should start there. Because I do believe that where we're from does shape who we become. And I'd love to know, as we start the conversation off, how growing up in Burton shaped your worldview as a human, but also perhaps your perspective as a storyteller and an artist.
That's a big question, Matt. I don't know.
Only the big guns, Paddy. The big guns.
Where to start with something like that, you know? Burton-on-Trent is just a small town in the Midlands. I guess it wasn't really so much about growing up in the town itself. It was more about the area that I grew up in, which was a housing estate called Winsel. And I grew up there, you know, in a council house. I'm one of, how many of us is there? Six of us as kids, you know, Irish family.
Two boys, four girls, right?
My brother, Chubby, and I've got four sisters, yeah. So, yeah, I mean, you know, I'm not sure where to start with how it shaped everything around me, you know, but...
Some of the local characters that stood out to you as a young kid? You know, because I think when I was going to come through and see you and spend the day there, and we didn't get time to make that happen. But when I came to see you in Lichfield for the Riding the Low gig, I said to you after the show, I was like, I get it now. I get some of these characters you've played in other films and, you know, the stories that you've told as a writer and a director. I can see how much of that specific area of the UK has bled into everything that you do.
Yeah, I suppose so. Yeah, well, I mean, it definitely does. Your world shapes you, you know. Like when I was, I was a kid, my father was an Irish immigrant. My mother was half Irish. Her dad was born in Dublin. And we grew up on this estate. And, you know, I grew up in a sort of world where I didn't know any of my friends whose dads didn't go to prison. You know, I thought that was a normal thing that dads did. And I look back at my life now and I see a lot of the friends around me that they were all from broken homes, you know, all of them. Some of them had no mother and some of them had no father. So we were all sort of, I suppose we were broken kids really. And they were my tribe when I was a little boy. We used to run like a little pack of dogs. And Winsel to me, where I grew up, was a bit of a sort of, I don't know if it's partly because of my imagination, but I thought it was quite a sort of a unique place, like smack bang in this housing estate. But beyond us, there was all these beautiful fields that you could look out at. And I always thought that it geographically, it looked great. I always imagined that I was in some kind of Stephen King novel, you know, with the church on the hill and things like that. But, you know, my sort of fascination with drama and stories, I suppose, just grew from being in my household, the kind of characters I grew up around and the world I grew up in, the sort of television I was watching as a young guy and the sort of music I was listening to, really. But to put the men in perspective, they were males, you know. They were fighting and drinking and fighting men. That's what they were. They were working men mostly that I was around, and you know, the women were wives who sort of stayed at home. I think I'm mythologized, maybe I've made up a word, but I think I probably did that to these people. You know, there was a lot of characters around the estate. A lot of them, for some reason, used to dress like cowboys, which I always found quite interesting. There was always a cool boy, Philemon. You know, some guys literally would dress like cowboys. Go to the pub with a poncho on and a cowboy hat. And this is
without irony as well, right?
This was before line dancing and shit like that. You know, this was like, you know, back in the 70s and early 80s and things like that. So, yeah, it's a very broad thing, Matt, because, you know, I grew up with that and I sort of had sensitivities as a little kid that my brother and sisters didn't have, you know. And so I interpreted the world differently, probably by not being sort of, they would say, neurotypical, whatever that means. But I just interpreted things differently. I was a sensitive kid and I grew up in a house where there was sort of, you know, it was a dysfunctional household. The happiest times were when my dad was away working or if he was in the nick. And I found a great happiness came to the house in those times. But then when he came back, you know, I would see the behaviors change of everybody around. He dominated the atmosphere. He dominated the room. I loved him so much. Still, you know, still do write about him in songs. And in a way, I think I get my ability to be a performer from him. Because I used to shoot like footage of him talking in the mirror, having a shave, and it was like watching Marlon Brando. It really was. It was astonishing. And I'm just a bit frightened to go back and look at that footage, you know, because I captured it. But I don't want to paint him as a terrible man. He suffered himself, you know. He was in Ireland in all the schools and he suffered abuse at the hands of the priests and things like that. So you're talking about broken people before you start, and then they've got these kids that they're raising, and but I love them immensely. We did our best. That's all we could do. But I guess I was a kid with a massive imagination and aspirations. I lived in my own little world, I suppose, but all the while I was sensitively interpreting all this sort of stuff around me. And you use the word violence and it sounds like it's something from a very violent film, but it's very, very subtle things. You know, like when you're a little boy and you're coming down the stairs and there's a cupboard ripped off the wall and your mum's sitting there with a black eye and there's a little kid who's probably 6, 7, 8 years old and no one speaks about it, but you sort of know who did that, you know. And those are really hard things for a kid to sort of try and come to terms with. You know, it's very confusing because this person's supposed to be your protector, really. So my dad was unpredictable, and it sort of put in me this fear of men, in a way, you know, a fear of being around men. I you know, I have all these sort of problems going into a room full of people, and if I'm walking past a crowd of men, you know. So I developed this sort of carapace to keep people away from me. But really, I was just afraid, you know, of confrontation and things like that. So I was quite a scared kid, really, as it happens. And, you know, my only thing was that I didn't realize this, but I was people don't like using this word, right? But I think it's important. I was an artist. And that's not a wanky thing because it gave me an identity. It gave me something that I could call myself, and I wanted that. You know, I didn't realize that until I was in my late teens, but I couldn't be a footballer. I couldn't be a boxer. What was I going to define myself as? I didn't realize that I was an artist. That's what I was. And to me, that was a great thing to find out about myself, because it gave me then the opportunity to interpret all this stuff that I'd digested through my life. And then I could put it into songs and into films and in performances. So I suppose, yeah, in that sense, the whole environment shaped my world. The problem comes when you start to limit yourself a little bit and, you know, disclude yourself from things just because you're from that sort of background. You have to learn to peel away the conditioning, and then the world becomes a much sort of bigger place, you know, for you. Like, for example, I never thought I would ever do something like Shakespeare. That was for clever people. How would you even direct a film? How would you do that? I wouldn't even know how to begin. The only thing that felt really easy to me that you could put together was making music. That's easy. There was kids down the back of our garden doing things like that. Growing up with punk, and I mean, I wasn't a punk. I was a little boy. I was born in 73. But my sisters had punks who were their boyfriends and things like that, and they bring their record collections around. And I go through all their music, and it sort of gave me the same sort of ideas in my head that you could just go and achieve anything if you just get, as John Lydon says, get off your arse. And I sort of had that mentality, you know, about me. I knew that I had to swim to survive. And I wanted to transcend the town, even though I still live there mentally. I had to transcend the town, but I still write about it in songs, you know, a lot of stuff about it on the new record, you know, places where I grew up, they're just dropped in there and things like that. But yeah, I guess it did shape my world.
In terms of like mentors, do you remember being a kid and you're watching films, you're hearing music, you're getting inspired by art? Was there anyone in your life that encouraged that side to your personality and showed you there was a way of achieving it? Obviously, punk shows you that it can be done, but was there people on a personal level that put their arm around you and said, you've got a skill, let's nurture it? Or was it just down to you to develop it yourself?
No, I didn't think you could do anything. I had teachers at school that I loved and who brought out the artistry in you. I used to draw as a kid. I can't draw anymore. I can't write, really, my name. I really can't. You know,
he knows it. He just can't write.
I used to be able to write, and my wife will say, "You can't. I can't write anymore. Like this sort of like sort of condition that I have. I can't even fucking write properly anymore. You know, with a pen. So I just lost my ability to draw. Can't do it. But I had a teacher in junior school called Miss Griffiths, and she was a wonderful lady. She'd tell us ghost stories, and I loved her. You know. And she encouraged a lot of that sort of, you know, artistry in me. But then you have her for a year and then you're with some fucking tosser, you know, for the next year. And I hated it. I hated school. But, you know, I call them angels. Along the way, I just, what I had was this. I couldn't go anywhere without having a fucking label on my back. So literally friends would not, like some of their parents outside of my circle of the kids I've described, wouldn't let me hang around with their kids. I'd literally have doors shut in my face and I'd be like standing there and going, well, what have I done? You know, you're not hanging around with him. And I'm like, I wasn't a kid that got into trouble, but there was a reputation around the name of my family that meant that I had doors closed on me.
Because of your dad?
Yeah, I think it was mainly because of that. Yeah, because he'd go out fucking. And there was older youths as well sometimes. And I'm amazed I didn't get beat up. And then I'd realize what it was. I think, why is that guy off with me? Then I'm real, oh, okay. My dad probably fucking beat him up one weekend. You know, it was like, it was a bit precarious to say the least. But so I just had this label and I had very low self-esteem, you know, just had that as a kid, felt dirty. And you know, my mom did her best, you know, to keep us clean and that. And then after so many years, it was just, I felt a bit feral, you know, and I don't really know what that was, but I remember being at school as a teenager, about 13, and going, what's that fucking smell? And it was me. I stank. And I'm like, what the fuck? I wasn't even bathing and things like that, you know? I had scabies and shit. And I'm like going, I look at it now and I'm like, wow, that's...
Is that because psychologically you had such little regard for yourself, you weren't even aware?
Yeah, I didn't know. I didn't realize. I had no clue. I just felt dirty. I felt... sort of, you know, not. I still feel it to this day, like not deserving of things, you know, always the one on the fringes, not fully at the fucking party, you know, just a bit of an outsider, really. So, you know, I carried that through and I was a bit ashamed, you know, of like my old man's behavior and things like that. And the house, we never had fucking wallpaper even at times, you know, and it was like, I felt ashamed of those things. It's hard to admit. So I always felt like a little bit secondary to everybody else, I suppose. But, you know, I went out and got a Top Gun haircut and things changed, man. Girls started fancying me. And, you know.
The rest is history.
The rest is history.
It's interesting that you say that, though, Paddy, because I know everybody who I speak to about you would just assume, because you're a guy who's in command of a certain skill set that's evident, if people have seen you in a film or on a TV show or on stage in your band, they look at you and go, wow, that guy's gifted. He's got something. So it's strange for people, I think, to know that even people such as yourself, who've achieved so many great things, still go through that crippling sense of self-doubt.
It never, never stops, ever, ever. You know, it's one of those things that I have to deal with, and I know I'm going to have to deal with it all my life. I don't want to make this, you know, depressing, but it's just, it's a saboteur, and it's in me, you know, and it's tried to stop me doing everything, this voice, and it's just a kid.
When you're young and you're getting some exciting early roles, and, you know, I guess you're full of excitement for the art.
I never thought I was any good. You know, when the first thing came out, Romeo Brass, I just felt, like I didn't think it was very good acting at all, you know, and so I was surprised with everything that came beyond that, and I was just going along with it because, you know, I'm working with then Pavel Pavlikovsky in my next film, and then Jim Sheridan, and I'm going, well, I must be doing something right. I don't know what I'm doing, but I must be doing something right.
Fake it till you make it, right?
Yeah, and that's how I felt. I thought, so, you know, I'm going to get called in, I'll get that tap on the shoulder, and it'll all be over, and everyone will realize how fucking rubbish I am. I always felt that. But I didn't quite understand the power of this voice until many years later. And I thought it was just associated with acting, funnily enough. Like, I hate acting. When I was in, I'll explain that better in a minute. But like, what happened? And I'll explain it now why I say that. It fucking challenges me to look at this stuff, and I don't want to open the door to it. Because I have this critic that tries to sabotage every single moment. And I've literally done performances when that voice is just going, you shit, you shit, you shit. And I feel shit, you know, and I battle my way through it and scrape through it. But it got so debilitating to me that I just thought, I can't fucking do this anymore. You know, this is too much. And I felt like that for years and years. And it wasn't until, if I'm honest, I got offered a play. Because I wanted to quit. I couldn't handle it anymore. I couldn't handle all the doubt and all the self-deprecation and things, you know. And I had Twitter at the time, and people would put up terrible things. And, you know, you think you
never read the comments, mate.
No, but you talk to people around you, and they go, well, you have to cope with it. That's what you're doing. I go, nothing equips me for this shit. I'm not, I don't have the fucking stones to deal with this, man. I don't have it. I'm not that kind of guy. I don't know. I'm hurt. You know, I'm fucking hurt. I'm not supposed to be, but I'm feeling this and I don't like it. I want to get out, get the fuck out of it. And that time I've got like a wife and, you know, and my children. But something about acting has always pulled me back. And it's just because it's always about facing that voice, facing that particular demon. And you can't let it win. Now, it's not always powerful. Sometimes it's weak. And I'm on top of it, but if I don't look after myself, if I don't meditate, if I don't exercise, if I don't look after myself, it can creep in and come back really, really powerfully. But I managed to, when I did a play called The Ferryman.
Did anybody see The Ferryman? I got to see it.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
I feel like I'm not talking to you. I did a play called The Ferryman.
Hello.
I got sent this script and I read it and I just went, oh God, oh fucking hell, man. Because I knew what it was. I knew it was a challenge, and it challenged every fucking demon, every doubt. This script challenged it, because I've got to go out on a stage. I've got to do hundreds of shows, and I've got to do it in front of, I didn't know at the time, but it would be nearly 1,000 people a night. And on a stage, there's nowhere to hide. You can't hide within yourself. I do these performances and people go, beautifully restrained. And I go, I'm not restrained. I'm fucking terrified. I don't know how to act. You know, I had to learn how to act is basically it. I can improvise with anybody. Not a problem. I can do that. But what's the point of being a one-armed fighter? I'm going to have a short career, aren't I? I've got to learn how to work with text. I had no education in acting. And that's fine. Some people are better actors than me. I'm not like that. I can't play the fucking chords. I'll play the notes, baby, but I don't know chords. And I got that from B.B. King. He said that to
it's
you.
A great
too.
Line.
Yeah. He said, I don't know how to play chords. I'll just do the notes. And I'm like, I can do the notes. I can do the big notes, but that shit, I can't do it. You know?
It's really interesting. I'll share a quick story with you. I met Taron Egerton once, and he was talking a lot about Stephen Graham and yourself and the reverence that, I don't know how classically trained he is, but there's a reverence that I've felt with actors and performers that I've met who look at that school that, you know, people like yourself are from, where it is quote unquote untrained. Mm. And there's such a rawness and an honesty there that the people, Danny Mays is another one, the people who've gone to RADA and have gone through the educational system to learn the craft, I know that they all look at people like yourself and they go, I wish I had a bit of that. So I guess it's like that kind of grass is always greener thing.
You ain't going to get it.
Yeah, you've either got it or you haven't.
You ain't
going
to get it. You ain't from my fucking, you ain't cut from that cloth. You're not going to get it, you know, but that's okay. You know, you're great at what you want to do. I didn't train to be in Dead Man's Shoes. I didn't train for that. That's that world you spoke about. That's where I got him from. That's my dad, you know? That's the guy that would wait 6 months to fucking go down and cave someone in that had offended him, you know, or offended his daughter, one of his daughters, or whatever the situation. That was that guy, you know? So these things are coming from experience. Now, acting allows you to, you don't need that. I've just played a king. You know, I'm not a king in any way, shape, or form.
Any Game of Thrones fans? I sure am. I can't wait to see that.
I just played a king. And like, you know, I shouldn't be playing a king, that little shit kicker. But this is the thing. You can't let these backgrounds. What I want to see is better opportunities for working class kids in terms of people going in. And I never get asked to do it. But to talk to them, you know, people from where I'm from and say, look, this is the world. This is the opportunities that you can have. Not everyone's going to make it, but you can just broaden your scope a little bit and look beyond the factories like I did. If you want to, you can, just to inspire people to write, because we still need those voices in film and in music. You need them. But at the same time, a kid like me can't limit himself by going, oh, I can't play a king. I don't want to play like Prince fucking Charles, but I'll play a fictional king in something mythical. Why not? Why shouldn't I do that? Anthony Hopkins did it. You know, I'm going to do it. So you can't have limitations, but I have admiration for people that went to school. I didn't learn about acting, and I am still learning, by the way. This is not something that's over by any means. I can produce naturalism and rawness. That's great. But I can't pick up the telephone and go, hello, oh yeah, can I have a taxi please to work? I just feel like the biggest twat in the room. And I get offered these cop things all the time and I go, I'm not that guy. I can't do it. I can play a cop in Red Riding, the Red Riding trilogy, because there's something there, you know, there's conflict, there's interest. But someone's just going, at 9:15 we saw the van in Brick Lane and at 10:30 we went down there. I'm not your fucking man, you know? Don't ask me to do that because I can't do it. I can't play chords.
How did you find The Informer? Because I don't watch a lot of cop drama stuff, but I watched The Informer and I thought you were brilliant in that. And I think there the conflict is, you know, he obviously goes undercover into that fascist organization and kind of gets sucked in. Was that part of the attraction of that role? Was the kind of, because you were great in that.
I've never seen it, mate. I've never seen it. I don't.
What drew you to the project then?
I just done a play and I was fucking skinned. No, that's really cynical. That's not true. But listen, in all honesty with that, I did struggle because I was going like, and I remember I said to my agent at the time, they need an actor to do this. They need someone who can play chords, you know? And I'm like going, and they're going, no, no, you'll be great. You can do this. And I'm like, but I struggle with those things, you know? And that was, I'd just come off playing this role in the West End that was a real journey, you know. It was an incredible journey I went on. I don't know how good I was at the end of it. I don't really care, because that's where I learned how to be an actor, by learning a bit of craft, doing my apprenticeship at last, and repetition night after night the same thing. And it took me until we did it on Broadway, 3/4 through that run, you know, for me to go, wow, I get it. I've been putting all this weight on myself to perform, to fucking, you know. And I'm going, it's just there, man. It's just right in front of you. You haven't got to do anything. You just have to be. That's it. So I had to sort of go through that process, and I had a great director, Sam Mendes, holding my hand to begin with through it, because I didn't want to do it. But it was like an officer and a gentleman, you know, when fucking Louis Gossett Jr. is, you know, trying to make him quit, and he's going, I don't want to quit. You know, and he goes, what are you fucking doing here? And he says, you know, and he basically says, I've got nowhere else to go. And it's a wonderful film. And Sam said that to me once. He goes, when we were in rehearsals, I sound like a nightmare, but I'm not. He saw the fucking hurt in me. He saw what I was running from. That's why he's a genius. He saw the hurt that I was running from and the insecurity and the self-doubt, and he helped me confront it. And he said to me one day, do you actually even want to be on that stage? I went, no, I fucking don't. And he went, why are you here? I said, because I've got nothing. I've got no choice, was my word. I've got no choice. And he knew what I meant by that. I've got no choice, because if I don't do this, I'm going to, this is it. This is the end, because this thing's just going to eat me whole. You know, this sort of voice in me, this doubt, this little boy. He's just a little boy. And that's it. But then what happened was, I thought it was around my acting. Music was my escape. Now the music's starting to go into other sort of realms. Coming in now to that. You're fucking shit, mate. You can't write a fucking song. People don't want to hear this fucking crap. And I went, oh, okay. This is not about acting. This is about something else. And this isn't a different voice telling you. This is the same source. This is the same thing. You know, this is the same thing, but it just wears different hats. And to realize that, when you can't allow it. I don't care if you fuck every note. I don't care if your voice breaks. I don't care if you break down crying. You're going on that fucking stage. And I would rather do that than run. So, you know, I feel... thank you. Yeah. So I feel it's, in a way, you know, it's sad it took so long, but I just throw my... I just have a little bit more knowledge now that other people have that I don't. Even raw actors have this sort of... thing that I just look adrift. I look at scenes from things that I was in, even this Game of Thrones thing, and I go, everyone looks like they're doing a really good job. I look like a fucking idiot. And I always look like the guy who's like, shouldn't be there, but.
In your head.
Yeah, yeah, in my head. So I just now throw it away. I don't care anymore. It's exhausting. I'm 48 years old. I've fucking had enough, mate. I can't be going to, you know, be 60 years old and still having all this shit in this same way. That's going to be tragic, you know? But what I do have is a great drive, and that's got me through everything. This idea that I have to swim. I have to swim. I can't sink. I have no choice. But as I get a little bit older, I'm starting to realize that you can have a 12-round fight and you can get smashed in your face and you can fight like Manny Pacquiao, or you can learn a bit of Floyd Mayweather technique and do 12 rounds but slip the shots and, you know, put it. And I'm going, I think I kind of want to start living my life a bit more like that. The fight makes it 10 times harder. The mentality makes it 10 times harder than it needs to be. So there's ease there. It's easing a lot, you know?
I think everything in life as well, it's true of every profession, every person. There's only a very select few people that are just born gifted. So few. Most people just have to keep doing it, and through the act of doing it, you improve and you get better.
Yeah.
But if you give up, you'll never know.
Yeah, absolutely. You've got to go through it. And you spoke about Taron. What's wrong with Taron's acting? There's nothing wrong with it. There's nothing wrong with it at all. He's doing
got
that
same voice, obviously. That says,
yeah,
I'm
we
not
all
that.
Have. That's the crippling thing, is that many, many people have. And, you know, only a narcissist wouldn't have it.
Gene Simmons doesn't have it. That's what makes Gene. So I want to ask you this. You mentioned earlier on about your dad and the experiences that you had in Ireland as a kid. When you get offered the role as the priest in Peaky Blinders, is all of that going into your portrayal of that character?
Yeah.
That character, by the way, is... I mean, that show's had so many amazing, huge name villains and despicable characters. And yours, for me, just is skin crawlingly horrible in the best way because of that performance. You seen Peaky Blinders?
Yeah, I wanted to play that part. I got offered it and I read it. And my only condition was, because I read the episode and I went, I've got him. I know who this guy is. He's an absolute narcissist. He's a pig. He's a glutton. he has no regard for these Peaky Blinders. He couldn't give a fuck at who they are, you know. And I hadn't watched the show, if I'm honest. I'm aware of it, like everybody, but I hadn't watched the show. And I just thought, this guy has no regard. And that's his weakness. He is with powerful people, but he is not a powerful person. He's not even a priest, you know, really. But there was a sense of you play a part like that and you kind of go, yeah, these are the kind of guys in a way that were inflicting that damage on these kids. Kids like my father, it was people like this, you know. And so I was glad that he got his date with destiny. But I had one condition when I read that, because I read the episode. I don't remember which one it was, and it got to the end, and then it alluded to child abuse, and I just went, I'm out. I said, if they want me to do this, because there's sometimes on when you're doing a television show, they're not all written, or they're being rewritten as you do it. And I said, I am not doing one fucking scene that depicts me with a kid in any way, even holding their fucking hand in that respect. There's one thing we shot at Easter, you know, and there's kids running around and he's messing up, but I'm like, anything. I remember we did the Red Riding trilogy and Peter Mullen, you know, great actor. And I remember one morning seeing him on set and he was shooting the third one. And I says, hey, mate, how are you, Peter? And he goes, oh, fucking dear, I don't know. And I was like, what's up, man? And he said, I've got to go and shoot that scene this morning where I hold the kid's hand. And he was in fucking bits doing it. Just the thought of having to do it. He was in such discomfort. And he played a horrible priest in that. Have you ever seen the Red Riding trilogy? Yeah, I think that's been lost somehow. How are you?
They're North.
He's from Vegas, this guy is.
No, you stay down here, mate. So I was just, that was my condition for Peaky Blinders, was like, I'm not doing any depiction, you know, fuck that. And they assured me, they went, no, that's not going to happen. So I could actually put that out of my mind. And that's never what I even played when I was playing the character. You know, I never thought about that aspect of the narrative, you know, at all.
How is it working with Killian? Because I think his role in that series throughout is a masterclass of acting. I think he's just incredible in it.
I really enjoyed working with him. Very good dude. One of the best. Really, really. I mean it. I had a really nice time with him. And I had to do some horrible things, kick him in the head and all that and whatever. I can't remember. But yeah, no, he's a lovely guy. You know, for this is the thing, you know, he just gets on with it. And that's fantastic. He's professional and he's brilliant. And he's a great presence to be with, you know, and that's what it's all about, isn't it? You know, just be setting the standard for it all. So I enjoyed all my scenes with Killian. I had a great time.
Looking back through your filmography, and I've been doing my homework in the lead up to this chat, one theme that I've noticed, which you might not be aware of, it's just maybe something weird that I picked up, but throughout your career, you've been so blessed to work with some of the best actresses in the UK, almost like right before they break every time, even going back to like My Summer of Love with Emily Blunt, who is fantastic. Has anyone seen the film My Summer of Love? So, so good. Came out right around the time of Dead Man, didn't it? And it's...
Yeah, we shot it the same year as Dead Man's Shoes, yeah.
The main two that spring to mind is your films, Tyrannosaur with Olivia Colman and Jodie Whittaker in Journeyman, obviously right before the Doctor Who thing, and she becomes a household name. And again, she was established. But Olivia, before Tyrannosaur, what made you think that she could pull off that role? Because as far as I was aware, before that, she kind of done The Donk and Scorsese, which is Paddy's best film ever, I think. And well, hopefully, I want to talk about that later. And Peep Show. And then, like, she's in this hard-hitting, gritty, intense, powerful thing. And yeah. What did you see in her?
Well, the story is this. The first thing was Dog Altogether. It was a short film that became Tyrannosaur. And that's what Olivia was in. So Olivia got the part in Dog Altogether because we went to the read-through for Hot Fuzz. And we just, and this is not bullshit, this is true. We went to walk through the door at the same time. And I said, after you? She went, no, after you. You know, and I looked at her. And then we did the read through, whatever. And I rang my wife and I said, I found her. Who is she? Her name's Olivia Colman. What's she been in? I don't know. I think she'd been in that thing, that show, Peep Show. Because I'd seen it on telly, but I'd watched it much later, you know. And that's a great show, Peep Show. So, and that was it, man. That was it. We did Hot Fuzz together and, you know, got to know Olivia a bit when we did that. She had a little role in that. And then we came to making Doggle together. And that went on to do well as short films can do, you know. Got a BAFTA and things like that. And then it came to making Tyrannosaur, which was Doggle together really was me just saying, can I tell a story in 12 minutes? And when I did it, and it had its success the way it did, people kept asking, what happens to the characters next then? So I sat down one day at the keyboard and I went, I'll find out for you. And I sat and wrote Tyrannosaur and wrote it in a week. And Tyrannosaur is the story. That is what's on the page. It's not an improvisation. That used to piss me off when people thought that. It was written on that page and that was the story. It wrote itself in a week, beginning to end. And even when I went in to try and tweak stuff, thinking, oh, I'll be a writer and tweak it, didn't want it. It's like, this is the story you need to tell. I had a vision on that and it knew what it wanted to be. Then when it came to making Tyrannosaur, which is now the feature film, I'm sitting in a room with financiers and they say, so who are you thinking of for the lead? And I say, Olivia Colman. And they're like, oh, really? And I go, yeah. Oh, well, haven't you thought of X, Y, and Z? I said, no, I haven't thought of them. I said, she's a blank canvas. I said, nobody knows anything about her. If I cast X, Y, and Z, when this character walks into the shop, you're going to know she's already damaged because of their body of work. Oh, how do you know that she can do something like this? I said, I fucking don't. But neither do you either. I said, all I know is that I have a feeling about her. She's the one. And if I'm being an actor myself, I'm going, well, if she doesn't get the chance, how will she ever know? Because that's how the film game works. I've had people say, you know, that I can't play certain things. The Red Riding trilogy, you know, there was things, oh, well, I don't see him playing a detective. And it's like, well, I'm never going to get the chance, am I? You know what? So I was going into it with that experience. So I said, I just have a feeling about her and that's it. Now we come to shooting the film. And this is an honest story. I tell it from the heart because this is about creativity and the nature of a journey of making something. We shot the first week of Tyrannosaur and some of it wasn't going very well. Olivia is a lovely, lovely person. And she loves the family. And she was always on her phone looking at photos. Oh, I've just been sent a photo. And I could see that it was affecting her concentration in between takes. Oh, look. And I was just a bit like, and I went to her. I said, put your phone down. Put your phone away. I said, you have to commit. We'd done research. I'd taken her to meet people, you know, Christians and the woman who ran the charity shop who dealt with situations like the one she deals with. And so that was the first thing. And then I shot a scene. This scene was a brilliant scene on paper. Amazing scene. I even sat back after I wrote it and went, where did that come from? That's amazing. Great scene. I come to shoot it and Olivia's not there. She's just not there. And I'm going, And I have a word with her and I say, Olivia, you know, what's stopping you? I said, look, you've got to understand, these aren't your beliefs. They're Hannah's beliefs. They're not yours. Whether you believe it or not about in God or whatever the fuck you want to, they're not your beliefs. They're hers. You've got to own her. You have to own her. And she wasn't fully getting it. So at the end of that first week, I shot her angle again, her close-ups. Now, if you reshoot something, I said, I'm going to shoot your close-ups again because I don't think you were there, you know, and I need to see you believe this. So we shot it. And I didn't know this, but she went home that weekend and she sort of had a talk with her husband. And she says, I'm letting Paddy down. I'm not giving him what he needs. And I don't know how the conversation went like that, but she came back on the Monday. And what I witnessed from that point onwards was true transformation. I saw her become a fucking force of nature. But it wasn't out the bag, and it took time. And she got it. She didn't go home again. You know, she got it. She knew what she had to do to commit to make this work. And, you know, I would be in scenes literally lying at her feet, directing her, throwing things to her, just giving a little note. You know, she's laughing at her hands and I'm just lying at her feet, feeding her things to make her laugh and using little tricks, getting her to run up and down the stairs to get her in a frenzied state, little techniques and things that I'd used myself. It wasn't Kubrick, Shelley Duvall territory, let me tell you that. There's still a lot of love there. But it worked, but she committed and she became powerful. That's transformation to me. And it was a great thing to witness. And it proved to me that my instincts were right. And it validated me as a film director and as a writer with that particular one. So that story with Olivia is one it's one about a revelation to me. And one that I'm very, very proud of and proud to have witnessed. I knew she was going to go on and do what she did. I wish I'd have written it in an envelope, sealed it, and gone, open that fucker in 10 years, you know? Because you knew then that the doors were open and off she went. And there she is now doing her thing. But it was great. The whole thing of making Tyrannosaur was one of the greatest experiences of my life. You know, I've never been so congruent. I've never been so in tune with whatever the fuck that thing is. Nothing could faze me. I was just on a mission with that and nothing got in the way of it. So it was the most, it was a brilliant creative experience and there was no distractions, nothing. There wasn't actually, that was one of the few times in my life where there was no doubt whatsoever in terms of what it was that I was trying to make, you know.
And it's one of the best British films ever made, I'd say. Has anybody seen Tyrannosaur and would attest to that too? I watched it today again for the first time in years and it's just so intensely powerful, man. Everything about it, from the way it's directed to the music, the performances. And, you know, there is that realism there, but it's not, as you say, an exercise in improvisation like it's obvious certain other projects that you've been in are.
Yeah.
It's scripted and it's, you know, it's fine-tuned.
Yeah, it is. It just knew exactly what it wanted to be. It was no doubt. Even in the edit, the edit of it, I mean, my producer remembers it differently, but it pretty much was the film was pretty much there from the beginning, pretty much. And there was a scene at Awake, and every time I screened the film, my editor would cry, and I'm going, Pia, fucking stop it, you know. But I'd be behind her. She didn't know this, but I'd be behind her having the same thing. I always had an emotional reaction when I was making it because I was making it for people that weren't with me anymore as well. And I was making it for my mother and father. My mother is the Tyrannosaur in the film that he describes, with the woman blind with no legs. That's how she ended up. So there was all these things in it. It knew we shot the wake scene and it was a very emotional scene. And, I went back, you know, a couple of days later and I watched it again and it didn't have the same impact. And I went, like, what's happening here? And P as an editor, she has to search for stuff, you know. She has to find stuff because directors will ask for stuff. You know, producers will ask for stuff. And she goes, oh, I've just changed it. And I found it. I went, no. If it works and we react in the way we are, there's nothing to change. That's what we're searching for, that reaction. You don't keep digging. You found it. Know when you found it. And it just knew what it wanted to be. It was like a beast shaking off fleas. Anytime you tried to turn it in a clever way or use a clever shot or use something, you know, oh, this is a filmmaker, it went fuck off. Didn't want it. And it was a very unique experience because of that.
Well, that scene elevates the soul as well because it's really heavy subject matter and it's, you know, these people's lives are bleak and hard. And that scene is like a bit of beauty amongst the shit where you see people smiling and singing and laughing and dancing and you see there. And that's what I love about both Journeyman and Tyrannosaur is, you know, it's sad and it's hard watching at times, both of those films, but they're ultimately, I think, love stories about two people.
Yeah, they're
very different love stories, but it's about the love that two people share and there's redemption there and there's hope.
Yeah. I thought Tyrannosaur was a love story. It was about two soulmates that found each other, but they were from different different backgrounds, you know, different parts of the divide. They were just not from the same areas. Society would not put those two people together. It just wouldn't happen. He's furious and angry and his own demented by his own demons. He makes judgments about her character and has no idea what she's suffering in her own private world. You know, so it's about these two dysfunctional people and they're falling in love with each other. And that's the tragedy of it. They actually fall in love with each other and they should be together in an ideal world. But he can't cope. You know, he can't cope with people around him. He can't cope with that sort of level of emotion. He can't do it. And she, you know, she's more savage than him. You know, she takes up the knife. He threatens it. He threatens kids. Fucking, you know, he smashes his shed down after putting his dog down. His anger's consuming everything and destroying everything around him. That's why he doesn't want her with him. You know, I'll fucking destroy you as well. Whereas she's already taken up the knife. So yeah, it is a love story. It's, that scene you talk about in the wake is really just showing her at ease with these people. In this world, she can be free of all her shackles and all the bullshit. And she can just be around these people and be free.
Eddie Marsden is one dark dude in that film as well. My God, he plays dark dudes very well, doesn't he? For a sweet guy.
For the one of the most beautiful men I've ever met in my fucking life. But that's the case, you know. He's a wonderful... I learned a lot of Eddie. I haven't heard from him for a few years, but... He understands it. He's one of the people that's got it all. You know, we talked about earlier the rawness and the craft. Eddie has that. Eddie's got it. He's one of those kind of beasts. I learned a lot from him about acting, a lot, and his approach to it. And he's an incredible guy. He was incredible in that film. It's funny, you know, Eddie told me a story once that. And when he started acting and I turned up on the scene, that he was wary of me, that he was afraid of me. And there was another actor he mentioned as well that he was wary of. I hope he wouldn't mind me saying this. But he did say, because I ended up working and becoming friends with both of those people and doing, you know, great work. And I'm like, isn't that strange? You know, how we were a little bit sort of like, you know, they're doing the things I want to do, or, you know, I should be doing that or whatever it is. But, you know, our paths cross. I met him on the Red Riding trilogy. I knew what an actor he was. I asked him to audition for me. And I apologized for that. I said, Eddie, I'm sorry I've asked you to do this. Because it's okay, Paddy. I know you have to get it right. It's your first film, you know. And I went, and he did. And he was the first one in the fucking door and he smashed it to bits. Like, all I wanted from the... I'm not going to make that film with Olivia, right? Because I felt quite protective and I'm not having some method actor strolling around, going, you know, like a fucking idiot. I'm like, no, I want quality. I want people that can switch it on and off. She has to be in the safest of environments. I'm not a believer in creating that kind of world for actors that I direct. I don't want them all being frightened. And no, you do your best work when you're at ease. And she was at ease all the time. In all those scenes, she was at ease. There was never any fear. You don't need it. You're fucking great actors. Go and get on with it. You don't need it. We know what we're doing here. If you're safe, I know I'm going to get a great performance. So all I had to do with that character was get someone opposite her that she was safe with. And Eddie sat with her and I don't know if they knew each other a little bit, but they were talking and that. And then they did a scene and Eddie did one of the scenes from the film. And then after he went like that and made a jump and they laughed about it. And I went, it's great. You know, he's the guy. And then I just turned to my producer, Dermot, who's my friend as well. I went, I said, that's it. You know, fucking done it. Let's go home. He's the man. And he went, well, there's like 20 other people who've come and they want to go, you know, we should at least see them. And I went, I know I've got him. And I just felt bad again being an actor. I gave every actor that came in the room the chance to do their best. I must have spent about, you know, sometimes nearly an hour with each actor just to sort of give them a chance to do something, you know. put them at ease, and but, you know, really, it's hard when you know you've found your one and then you're going to go through the day. You feel like you're wasting their time because it's such a vulnerable thing anyway, you know, auditioning for stuff. And
I think even if you don't get it, though, and I'm not an actor, so I can't speak from experience, but I would imagine if you don't get the part, you still learn from that process, right? And you can apply what you learned to the next audition and improve your chances of getting the next.
I suppose you
do. None of it's wasted time.
I don't audition for things. Yeah, I could have done a lot more work. I just don't. I can't do it. I don't like it. It's unnatural. There are people that I would,
so if
he says.
If the part is contingent on the audition, you...
Let me just put this straight. Olivia didn't audition. Peter didn't audition. I had to find the little kiddie in it, and Paul Popperwell was my mate, you know. So, you know, it was just the right person opposite her. I didn't want to take any chances in that role, you know. But no, I think it's awful auditioning. I can't stand it. Yeah, I just feel like, what's the fucking point? You know, can you put yourself on tape? And I'm like, no, I'm a human being. Meet me. Let's have a chat and a coffee. And, you know, I haven't. I've parted ways with an agent in America, you know. And I'm like, nah, I'm done, mate. I'm not playing that game. I don't care. I'm too deep in the fucking game now to do all that. And it's not a pompous thing. I'm sure I've lost more work than I've gained through it. But I just don't want to do it. You know, Sam Mendes didn't make me audition. So I'm not auditioning for people.
Well, I think everybody sets
go
their...
Go and watch a few things if you like it.
Everybody
give me the
sets their
gig.
Own lines, I think. If you're willing to audition, by all means audition.
But look, you know, it's a punt. I mean, you know, playing a king in this thing, it was a punt. You know, it was a bit of... If I'd have gone in the room and auditioned for that part, I wouldn't have got it. I mean it. I would not have got it. I wouldn't have got it. I don't work like that. And also, even at the read-through, I was reading it so terribly because I'm terrible at reading. And they're such unnatural things. You know, everybody's putting on their best accents, you know, and all that. And I'm like going, oh, Jesus Christ. And it's unnatural. It's horrible. And, you know, but they're good markers, those read-throughs, because you get the nerves out of the way. And then you go, yeah, because I'm nervous, I can temper that back now and start to build the character. So that's important. But I don't want to do any of that.
Come too far, mate.
All that nonsense.
We're going to open it up in a moment to the crowd. Before we do, there's a couple more things I want to get into. And one is Journeyman, because I thought it was an exceptional piece of filmmaking. I loved it.
Thank you.
I thought Jodie was fantastic in it opposite you as well. And the reason all of it was so believable was the two of you together. It's such a beautiful love story and the lengths that she's willing to go to and what she's willing to endure to make this partnership work. Is beautiful. Did you have her in mind when you're writing that part? How did she come into the mix?
Yeah, it was a different thing with Joe. It wasn't the same sort of revelatory journey that I had with Olivia, you know. That was something else, you know. I don't think I'll experience that ever again. I honestly don't. But Jodie was pretty established as a talent, you know. She was getting lots of work in things. I think she'd been in Broadchurch and stuff. But again, I hadn't seen Jodie really in anything. She was sort of a friend of my friend Nadia, who's a makeup artist, you know. And I met her. And I had a certain shape in mind for what I wanted that character to look like. And Jodie fit it, you know, and got on great when I met her. So that's how it started, really. And Journeyman was a different shoot to Tyrannosaur completely. I wasn't going to be in Journeyman, and I don't think I should have been, really, looking back at it. I think I should have cast somebody else in it. It wasn't, although it has a power and there's something in there, you know, I can't look at it. I find it hard to think about Journeyman. It's just... Unlike Tyrannosaur that knew what it wanted to be, Journeyman didn't quite for me. You know, I was acting in it, and what happened was I just got lost in the characters so much that I neglected other things. You know, I became so absorbed in those characters and in that character of Matty that I neglected to get little things as a director, you know. So it was like we had a great experience shooting it. And I came to the edit and I looked at it. And I went, where's all the fucking shots? Where's all the like we got, it was like Robin Aladdin's cave, filling your pockets with gold and coming out and going, it's just fucking metal, aluminium. It's just, it's nothing, you know? And that's what I felt like. I thought, what happened? Was I brainwashed in that experience? Did it brainwash me so much that I thought we were making something special? And I didn't. I the process of making Journeyman post-production was one of the worst experiences of my life. And I don't quite know how to still come to terms with it, you know. I think the difference is that when I did Tyrannosaur, I went, fucking have that. You know, when I made Journeyman, I was almost sort of going, I hope they like this. There was a bit of a second album buzz about it, you know. I wasn't as assured. I thought the performances were good enough, but I wasn't as assured in my execution of it as I was with Tyrannosaur. And I think that may be the difference, being that I might have wanted something from Journeyman that it didn't deliver me. And that was the big lesson from it.
Did you want to pay tribute to the people in that sport that go through what they go through? Was it?
Yeah, I did. But also in a sort of arrogant, sort of egotistical way, I'd written it, directed it, I acted in it. And part of me was going, fucking, I'll show these cunts. You know, fucking have a look at that. And nobody, and nobody, sorry for all the language. It's embarrassing. But I'm such a gobshite. But I just felt like a failure, you know. And
It was received okay,
but I this is the difference. I had expectations for it that it didn't meet, so I felt like a failure, and that's it. So there is a purity about Journeyman. There is a heart to it. But my struggle with it is that I had aspirations for it that it didn't meet, and I felt like a failure. I couldn't get it in a film festival anywhere in the world. Tyrannosaur went everywhere. I was competing with something in a way that I just couldn't. It was unrealistic for me to do that. But it was just being like Film Four were begging festivals to have it, and they didn't want it. And you're just hearing it going, oh, this is embarrassing. Like Film Four are begging people and they don't want it. I just felt ashamed. I thought, it can't be that bad. I know it's not amazing, but it can't be that bad. So I don't know. I sort of divorced it, really. But listen, here's the story about Journeyman. You know, like people romanticize boxing. And people in boxing watch that film, esteemed people in boxing. And they were telling me everything that was wrong with it as well. Nobody, you know.
Cheers, like, guys.
Yeah, they wouldn't do that. Or that wouldn't happen. Or the team wouldn't leave him. Or the, and I'm like, bullshit.
Yeah, some of that is their own fear
bullshit.
And insecurity, isn't it?
Yeah. Yes, they do. When that happens to a fighter, the only people that are left to pick up the pieces are the family. And that's it. And very close friends. You know, so all that sort of stuff, they like to sort of romanticize it a bit. It's not like that. It's an unforgiving sport. Even if you leave it at the top of the game with £5 million in the bank, it's still unforgiving, because guess what? A week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks later, nobody's talking about you anymore. You are one of the forgotten. But I wanted to show that in Journeyman, and also the compassion that boxing can have for its community, and how it bonds people. Because I'd been in the rooms with ex-boxers in London at London Ex-Boxers Associations when I was a student at Brighton, so I'd seen that side of the sport, and I wanted to show that too. But I don't know. I think some esteemed people, though, trainers and that, they've watched it, and they think it's great. Fighters don't watch it. I don't imagine they'd want to watch it. Retired fighters watch it. But then the thing I learned from Journeyman was, and all the art that you make, you just can't make it. You can't really make it with any sort of any goals or aspirations in mind. You've just got to execute it because it's driving you to do so. And that was the only lesson learned from Journeyman. It's not about me. I made a story about a man who lost his identity and had to come to terms with what he now was physically and mentally. So in that in that respect, it was a journey of someone. It was a journey of acceptance, you know, someone accepting their limitations. That's what it became about to me. But there's an MMA fighter called Michael Bisping. And I was, well, I first of all, a few years ago, my phone, I got up and my phone was pinging, pinging. I'm going, what the fuck's going on here? And I look at it and it's a load of mates going, do you know Michael Bisping? He's a UFC fighter, Michael. And he was, at this point in his career, lost the sight in one eye. He can actually take his eye out. So he's got a fake eye. And he was going blind in the other eye. And what had happened was he was flying to New York on a plane from Las Vegas. And he was going to do a podcast in New York. And he watched Journeyman on the flight. And he walked into this podcast and made an announcement. And they thought maybe he was going to announce his next fight. But he didn't. He said, I'm retired. He said, I've just watched a film on a plane called Journeyman by Paddy Considine. He goes, and that's it. That made his mind up for him watching that film. And I couldn't believe it. And a few weeks ago, I watched his documentary about his life story. And towards the end, it comes up and Journeyman comes up. And there's clips of Journeyman on it. And I look at it and I'm just blown away. And I kind of cried a bit because I went, fuck, this is not nothing to do with you. It's not about you. You're just the conduit. You're just the creator. That's all you've got to do. And then you make something and you put it out in the world and it's not yours anymore. It's not yours. This thing, when I saw it within the context of a man's life, you know, it flashed up and it was a part of this man's life story. I just went, how can it get any more powerful than that? How can it? What's the point if you don't make work that kind of reaches people, transforms people, or does something that makes people feel a little less alone in the world? I think we're just looking for familiar voices and people who've had similar experiences so we know that we're not alone. And I think that film does that, and I think music does that at its best. So the lesson was, you just got to do what you got to do because you love it and not get bogged down in the result and understand that once it's done and it's not yours anymore. That's it.
And your films are nothing if not affecting, Paddy Considine. And that film for me as well, like with Tyrannosaur, for me as someone who knows nothing of the sport of boxing, it's just a love story about what two people will do for each other when they truly love each other. And that end scene when Nick Cave, Into My Arms, is playing, rips my heart out. And I'd like you, as we approach the audience Q&A section, if you don't mind, I'm going to name drop for you. So this isn't Paddy, it's me. Please share the coolest story ever. So Nick Cave, Into My Arms, is in the scene. And what did Nick say to you in regards to that piece of music?
Well, he was willing to give me the stems to the music because I wanted to sort of not change his arrangement, but just, you know, leave a few bits out and all that. And he was willing to give me...
That's her jaw hitting the floor.
Oh, is that what that is? Yeah, he was willing to give me the stems to it. And I was just like, what? You know, and they said, all you've got to do is email him, you know, and tell him, you know, write him a letter and he'll let you do it. And I shout out. I went, I can't. I saw him in town as well once and I just couldn't approach him. You know, I was just like, I can't do it. He's too profoundly fucking brilliant for me. I adore him. That's a silly thing. I'll bump into him one day. But yeah, I was privileged that he was going to give me the actual source, you know, materials to be able to do something with. But you know what? This song is such a perfect, beautiful song. It didn't need changing or, you know, rearranging in any way whatsoever. It's a beautiful song, and that's why I wanted it in the film. So, yeah, that's that.
You got to be pleased with that one. At this moment, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce you to the gaffer, Terry.
Who's the gaffer, Tabby?
Who's going to run? He's going to run.
It's now, Tabby.
Tabby Tips.
Tabby Tips is it now, right? Apply a bit of bingo.
He's going to roam the room with a third mic. And if you would like to ask Mr. Considine a question, please put your hand in the air.
No maths questions. I'm not good at it.
Let's go to Mr. Las Vegas on the front row. He's traveled the furthest to be here.
I have two questions, one very quick one. Game of Pricks. Tiger Bomb or Alien Lanes version?
Alien Lanes. Alien Lanes.
I'm a Tiger Bomb guy, but okay.
Yeah. So, I have the original artwork to Tiger Bomb at home.
Nice. Yeah. Very nice. So you win. The other thing was when you were talking about you know, growing up where you did, and this is something I've seen in interviews with you and Stephen Graham and Eddie Marsden, and obviously I'm new here in town. So as an American who's been watching your films and for years, and I will watch anything you're in just because you're in it. But a lot of those class things that seem to be a big deal here, like people from the North or people who are from the working class. Like, I had no idea that any of that existed. Like, we have no concept that somebody from like Manchester or the Midland, like that doesn't exist to us. And so like when I get here and I start reading these articles about, you know, the people who are trained at RADA versus whatever. And of course in America, like we don't really do stage training for movie actors. We just give them a lot of cocaine and just say, go up there.
Off you go, mate. Yeah.
Right. But what I was wondering was two things. One was, do you feel that that's something that's changing here? And then also, when you've dealt with Hollywood, or American film productions, do you find that they deal with you differently than say like a director who's like, you know, trained throughout, you know, in the finest schools in London, you know, that kind of thing. Do you find that they approach you differently?
No, I think, you know, the class thing is just something that's existed, you know, and you know, when I was a kid growing up, the stuff on the telly, there was like Alan Bleasdale and Phil Redmond and, you know, Ken Loach and things like that. But they were telling stories about people, you know, from the working class and stuff. And so these were the people that I could identify with. So they were the things that we talked about. We talked about the films of Alan Clark and things like that. It's always been sort of, you know, British cinema's always been steeped in that sort of thing, you know. But I think I don't know what to say about any of that. I mean, you know, training's okay, man. It's all right to go and get some training in anything, you know. I always use boxing analogies, but, you know, Manny Pacquiao was a one-armed fighter till he went to Freddie Roach, and then it developed a backhand, and he was a different animal. Or he developed a hook, whatever it is. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. And I think there was a point where certain actors were winning a lot of awards and then they're going, oh, they're the Eton boys. I've never given a fuck about any of that. I don't care. You know, I enjoyed meeting people from other backgrounds. I don't feel they're more privileged than me because that really makes me a victim. And I'm not. I'm a talented man. And so I won't buy into any of that shit. I won't have it. I'll just try and do the best job that I can do. And I'm a working class kid who came up doing, you know, gritty British films. I've made some stuff myself. And, you know, like I said, then you're playing the King of Westeros and you're like sort of going, well, how did that happen? It's like, because I'm a fucking actor. And it, you know, and it's okay to do it. It's okay. That's the point. You've got to take away that conditioning. And just open the costume box and dive in and go, I can't do any of this. It's not a problem. When you mentioned Taron earlier, I think my reaction was, you can't give people the shit that you've been through. You can't. You know, you can't give that to somebody. You know, Edgar can't make Tyrannosaur as much as I can't make Baby Driver. You know, that's not to say you can't get in there and work with difficult subject matter, but this is who I am, and that's the difference. I feel, you know, a bit more that there's, I don't know, it's probably I have a few other different voices about me that makes it a little bit different for me, but there is an obsession with class in this country. I wish it wasn't so, but it's there. I just want to, if I could ever, you know, just encourage some of those voices, kids like myself that might have aspirations. When I asked one of my teachers how you become a film director, he told me, Paddy, you could never be a film director. And I believed him. I didn't even feel bummed out or gutted, or I just went, oh, yeah, he's right, you know. I didn't think I could be on Top of the Pops. That was for special people, you know, that was a reserved place. A lot of it is getting rid of the conditioning and the bullshit. And it's a lot of hard work. And being an actor is a lot of hard work, you know? And I think that's the best way I could answer it, really. I probably didn't answer it at all. They don't treat me any differently in Hollywood as they do in Watford.
Let's go to the lady with the blonde hair and her arm in the air with the yellow wristband. Although they've all got wristbands on. That's what you get, is it, when you come in? Huh, you got it.
Hey, hi. I'm your friend on Instagram. And
you're my friend?
Yeah, I'm your friend on Instagram. Sometimes you like the things I say.
Okay.
I'm really happy about that.
I hope that keeps up.
So, yeah, so I'd like to ask you about, like, directing, because I know how much you like horror. So have you ever thought about directing a horror film?
Yeah, I have. I've got a few horror stories in my and ghost stories in my mind. But I just feel a bit like if you're to make one of those, I wouldn't want to make a conventional horror film because a lot of them are crap. Most of them are rubbish. They are. I struggle to watch it. Although I like horror films, I struggle to watch a lot. And then this, like, my daughter loves horror. She's only 13 years old. And when she was 10, we were watching something like, she was 10, but we were watching I Know What You Did Last Summer. And she basically broke down the next three shots for me. Just stood there like, and she went, oh, they're going to do this, this, and cut to that, and then they're going to do that. And I went, have you seen this before? And she hadn't, but she just knew the rhythm of a horror movie. She knew the tricks as a kid, her formula. So she's watching it going, they're going to do this, they're going to cut to that, and they're going to go, and it did. So you'd have to strive to make something that wasn't so formulaic, I suppose. But I would like to make a really fucking scary film. Yeah. Like, The Exorcist scares me. The most frightening ones get under your skin. It's not the, you know, the man with the chainsaw for me. Yeah, that was a great film. I was writing something, actually, that I want... had similarities to the Babadook, not in terms of character in the book, but similarities. And it wasn't quite working anyway. And when the Babadook came out, I just went, ah, you see, that was the sort of territory you were going into, but they did something that was really, really great. And so, yeah, I'll have to see what happens.
Terry, let's do this. Oh, we're going at the back. He's mate Gail Porter, ladies
and
gentlemen.
It's my really boring
Hello,
self.
Hello, Gail.
Hello. So basically, I think The Shining is probably the most scary thing because it's psychological. No?
No, I that's mad you said that. I was watching something about that this morning.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Anyway, I'm not going to ask a question. I'm just going to say, on behalf of probably everybody here, thank you. Thank you.
Oh, bless you.
Because you know what? So much of what you said resonated with me, and I was thinking, do I keep my mouth shut or do I not? But do you know what? I'm Scottish, so I just keep talking and I can't help myself. But do you know what? It's the most wonderful, wonderful evening. Really, like, I've been in tears. I just loved every minute of it. Thank you, Matt. Matt, you're an absolute superstar. You talked to me. You talked to me. So
I didn't pay her to say any of this,
I know. I should actually get paid, shouldn't I? But also, I'm a second Dan kickboxer. So, do you know what? If you want me in a next movie, I'm in.
No problem.
But honestly, from the bottom of my heart, thank you. Thank you for your honesty. Thank you, Matt. Sorry, I'm going to cry again.
Oh, bless you. Thank you, Gail. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you, Gail. That was lovely. Let's go to the lady here and then the lady here. We'll do two down in the front row.
Hello. I've got a couple of questions. Quick one is, what's your favourite film in the Halloween franchise? Is it Three? Because that is definitely
been waiting
the best
all night for this.
Season of the Witch.
I love Three.
It's so underrated, right?
Yeah.
It's great. That was meant to be a quick question.
Was it? That was a quick one. Yeah. I love Three. I love the original.
Yeah.
What did you think to Kills?
It was better than I thought it was going to be.
Is it? Yeah.
But it doesn't touch Season of the Witch.
No, they've still got a chance to try and pull that one back, haven't they, with the new one?
Yeah.
Let's see what happens.
Okay, second question is, it seems like as time has gone on with regards to your career, especially when you were talking about the music, your ability to kind of fight that voice that's inside you, that negative voice inside you, has got kind of better, or you've got better, maybe not ignoring it, but like countering it with a, you know, fuck it, I'm going to do it voice. Do you think there's any correlation between that growth and kind of getting better at like self-care, which you said you do, like
definitely,
meditation?
Definitely, yeah. There definitely is. It was two sort of you know, it was overwhelming. I don't want to go into detail, but in my mid-30s, it was very, very dark on happy period. Just for me, you know, I felt like I was in my own little world in that time. But I don't want to sort of put too much detail on it, but it was awful. But a couple of things happened to me. One of them was after sort of a breakdown of the probably my third one, I was just like, I can't do this anymore. You know, I can't keep doing this. Every time I just felt a bit weaker, you know, and I thought, I ain't got one of these in me, you know, to keep coming back from. So I started to do the meditation thing. That was help. That helped me massively. And then eventually I was in New York and I was put in the way, and I always thank Sam Mendes and Sonia Friedman for this, but they put me in the way of somebody that I could speak to in terms of a psychologist and a bit of psychotherapy. And that helped like massively, because then I was able to identify the negative self-talk. And it was so subtle. This thing had had me under a delusion for nearly 30 years about something that had happened to me as a teenager. And that had occupied my mind, my whole existence for years and years. And I remember just walking down the street in New York, and I had this revelatory moment where I just saw through the delusion of it all. And that was a big moment in my life. And then it was sad because I saw it clearly, the grip that it had had on me for years and years. So with the positive self-talk and the meditation and exercise, now let me tell you this, there are times where I neglect it. And when I do, I go out of balance with it. The best times are when I'm meditating regularly. And when I'm able to do that and get into that calm, then I'm able to sort of, when I'm coming out, put in that self-talk. And it's not mumbo jumbo bullshit. The brain will take it, you know, it'll accept it. And it's a very powerful thing. So that's helped massively, but it's a practice that I need to do for the rest of my life.
Yeah, it's refreshing actually, because you don't often hear people talking about kind of struggles that might seem like easy to other people, like taking care of yourself.
Yeah.
And I think, it's kind of refreshing to hear you talk about that so openly. So thanks.
No, you're welcome. Thank you.
Hello.
You
actually worked with my cousin, Killian.
Is he your cousin?
Third cousin, twice removed.
One of them, is it?
He literally used to live around the corner in his favourite dosa restaurants down the road. Anyway, I was just thinking, you're really into your music and you hate acting. Right. You're evolving. This imposter syndrome is a fucker. I think everyone has it. Now, this is not more of a question, but it is.
Someone's been on
this?
The cocktails.
Listen, this I had to go.
Somebody
out,
should have had a mocktail.
I have agoraphobia. It's the first time I've been out in over a year.
Wow. There you go. That's great.
Well, thank you for choosing this night.
Thank you.
So we're talking about the second generation Irish thing. Sorry.
Yeah. You're doing great. Are you okay?
I'm okay. You haven't made me cry. I'm happy.
Emotions are good.
Now, could you please write and direct and star in a Shane McGowan biopic?
How could I ever play Shane? A handsome individual.
I don't see
individual.
How anybody else can.
Oh, I love Shane McGowan.
It's just a request. I just put it out there.
Did you watch that documentary? Amazing, wasn't it?
Crock of Gold.
Yeah, Crock of Gold.
So good.
Yeah. Maybe, yeah. There's a lot of very talented second generation Irish around, isn't there? Johnny Lydon.
Would you ever... Hey, lay off Johnny. He's all right, Johnny.
Hey, Johnny's all right.
Direct a documentary? Is that something that appeals to you in any way?
Maybe, yeah, if it was the right material. I got asked to do one years ago about Whitney Houston.
Whitney?
Yeah. bizarre things come through sometimes. And I'm like, you know, yeah, I'm not sure I'm your man.
What was the pitch? How come you were their guy?
I have no idea. I think, you know, I think people sit in these rooms and just randomly throw shit about.
They watch Dead Man's Shoes and they go, I got this great idea, guys.
Yeah,
he's the guy.
I'd love to make a great Guided by Voices documentary, you know, but I think, like, years ago, actually, Adam Buxton, he sort of put a proposal together and we were going to go out to America and do something, but Bob didn't want to do it. You know, he wasn't really into the sort of documentary thing, but I think there'd be a great doco there because they're very, very still as amazing band as they are. They're really unknown in some respects. What's the best rock doco you've ever watched? Music doc? Hey?
Documentary.
No, real one.
Doco. Anvil is an amazing story.
Great. Yeah.
Heart-wrenching. Inspiring. African-American punk band. Yeah, that is good.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Bang. Yeah, that was amazing. That actually made me cry, yeah.
I want to ask you, on the subject of documentaries / mockumentaries, Scorsese and Le Donc, or Le Donc and Scorsese. Did you have a good time making that? Because that, for me, when I watch it back, seems like two friends having the best time of their lives. It's so pure. It's so funny. It's so magic. There's such a heart there as well. It's just, for me, it's right. I'm not just saying this to be kind. It is right up there with Spinal Tap as one of the great musical comedy mockumentaries. Has anybody seen it? Le Donc and Scorsese. If you haven't seen it, you need to check it out.
Yeah.
Was it a fun shoot?
Yeah. No, it was. Yeah, we had a good laugh with it. We just turned up at this like festival that Arctic Monkeys were doing in Manchester at the cricket ground. And just made a mockumentary around it with this character that I'd kind of been doing this character for years because he was based on a guy from our town who was in a band. So I used to just kind of do impressions of him and all that, you know. And he morphed into this thing that was Le Donc. So, it was fun to do. It was, we had a good laugh doing it, definitely. It's not something I can look at, you know. I find it uncomfortable. I don't know why.
I'm noticing a theme here. That's kind of with everything, but
yes.
It's good though because you put it, you know, to the side and it's on to the next.
Yeah,
I think when you spend
to
too long looking back reverentially over your own back catalogue, it makes you static as an artist. You're not pushing forward.
No, that's true. Yeah, I don't want to put myself through that.
Where did you find Scorsese? Because he's a real life rapper, right?
Yeah, I don't remember. I'm being honest here. I don't quite remember. I that would have come through Shane and I don't remember if he'd just heard a song of his and then found out that he was in Nottingham. All I know is turning up and Dean was there, who's Scorsese. I can't remember. It was so many years ago, but he was great because he was just the perfect sort of sidekick in a way because Le Donc's such a motormouth and Dean was so sort of like chilled out and... it was sort of an aspirate. He was taking this rap act and trying to get him, you know, introduced to the music world. So what we managed to do with that is, so we went up in this camper van, I think, to Manchester, and we did a gig in front of like 50,000 people of a song that we'd written the night before.
Are you going, calm down, Deirdre Barlow?
Yeah, just come here. Yeah. So fucking hell, mate. I don't even know where it came from. But I was just putting names on a list. He does a shout out of all these names. And I think even Alex Turner and that, a couple of the guys were throwing in, oh, Monkey Magic, oh, this. And I was going, like, writing them down. So on the stage the next day, we just performed a song that we literally wrote. It's not a song, really. But Dean could rap. Dean can rap. He makes great music. And but we just wandered out and did it in front of all these people. It takes some guts, I suppose, really. But no, it was fun to make. It was, yeah. Maybe I'll revisit it one day.
Please do. It's like it's Andy Kaufman territory, is what that is. When you're out there in a crowd doing it, or Borat, or you know, it's that kind of style.
But I think that's it. You know, it gets a bit scary. You know, I think I was starting to get a bit sort of stressed with it, and like, and there was a lot of pressure because I was having to sort of improvise everything, and you know, it was on, and I was just sort of like times thinking, oh shit, you know, I don't know, but yeah. I don't think I'll ever do it again, you know, but I'll have a look at it one day.
Any more questions from the room? before we get the stage ready for some lab music. We'll do another one down the front. And if there's one more
in here.
Yeah, we'll do these two and then we'll bagger off.
I was just going to ask, you mentioned that Ledonk was based on somebody from your childhood. Was Morel in Room for Romeo Brass had some of the similar person, or was it literally just the dance that they both had in common?
No, he was. He wasn't actually like. He was sort of like the kid on the estate that you. There's always a Morel on the estate, but he wasn't based on any one person in particular. In actual fact, I was just playing a normal guy off the estate. But I'd started a friendship with this bare-knuckle gypsy fighter called Bartley Gorman. And I'd spent like summers with him, photographing him and hanging around with him. And basically, just before I started shooting Romeo Brass, I went to took a video camera and filmed Bartley. And because we were talking about going to Bodmin Moor to hunt the beast of Bodmin. And he did this fantastic thing to camera because he's related to Tyson Fury, you know, the boxer. So there's sort of, there's a similar lingo about them. And all that happened was, because I sort of like, when if I'm hanging around people, I start to sort of inflect their, absorb their voices and things like that. It's just something I do. And we were doing a rehearsal for Romeo Brass and Shane had a camera on me. And I didn't even think about it. It wasn't even the thought. I started talking like that, you know? Yeah. And it was like, and after I'd done this improvisation, Shane was just like, where's that come from? I said, I don't know. I said, I didn't even know. I said, I've been hanging around with Bartley. I said, don't worry. And he went, no, keep it. But then the character came really from that, like a couple of days before we started shooting.
So there.
Final question of the night to you, my friend, who's been taking photos for us. What are you going to ask? Here we go. Here's my mic.
No, I can't get you a ticket to Glastonbury.
No, so it's just what is one film that you had wished you had either written or directed? So one that's already out there, the one that you've just gone like, oh shit, I wish I'd done that.
I mean,
there's got to be one.
One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Yeah?
Yeah. I love that film. I think it's my favourite film of all time. So yeah, maybe something as great as that I'd love to have made. I'd love to have been in, you know.
Did you not do a stage adaptation of it?
What's not
that?
Me, no.
What's that painting from? Is that just a painting of you as?
Oh yeah,
character?
Some artist came and he was photographing. He was like painting people, and the idea was he was painting actors in roles that they wish they could play, and I was McMurphy, so he did a painting, and the chief was in the background, and yeah, it's nice, yeah. He did a series of different people. Yeah, but that was just a painting, yeah. That's about it, Matt.
Any more questions? I think we're ready for the interval. So please join me in saying a warm, heartfelt thank you to this incredible human being.
Thanks for coming. Thank you.
Mr. Paddy Considine.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Paddy.
Thank you. We can talk until forever, but it's in me all the same. Send me like cancer. Oh, anyone, if I summoned all my demons, would you kiss them away? Make love to the lake now. Oh, anyone, and I wanna go home, just to lie on my sofa. I'd like to breathe you in again. Oh, anyone, can you talk any faster? Never call yourself boring. Oh, anyone, let black masses shake. It's a shadow on the corner, recorded on the weather. Oh, anyone, a black masses shake.
Well, that's the end of the podcast, ladies and gentlemen. It wasn't the end of the live show. At that point, we took a break, and then after that break, Riding the Low, Paddy's band, came on stage and performed, I think it was 7 or 8
acoustic songs to a very excitable crowd thanks to Gail Porter. And I do have to thank Gail Porter here. Gail is a dear friend of mine. She's been on this show twice over the years. I've known her many years. She's just a beautiful, brilliant, lovely human being. And when Riding the Low started playing, obviously it had been a sat down interview show, so it was all quite, you know, tame and civilized. And Gail was like, I'm not having people sitting down for a gig. So she went around the whole room individually plucking people out of their seats and basically forced everybody to dance. And at first, you know how British people are, they were a little bit hesitant and shy and restrained. And then a few songs in, they were like, you know what, let's go. Paddy was encouraging them from the stage as well. And we ended up getting the whole room up off their feet, apart from me, actually. I was sat on the side just with the biggest grin ever. My friend May, well, a few friends came down that night. Gail was there. My friend Sam was there. My friend May was there as well. And there was a moment where I looked across the room and saw May dancing, and we kind of caught each other's eyes and had a big smile on my face. I was just looking around at this scene that, you know, Gail had instigated, but that I'd, if I can be so bold to say so, created by, you know, putting on the event and bringing everybody together for it. And it was just, it was a fun, wonderful, life-affirming, amazing night. And so I want to say again, thank you to everybody who came down. Thank you to everybody at the West Hampstead Arts Club, my favorite venue in London, and definitely going to be the home for many more of these live events that we're doing. What's up, Derek? Come on in. Don't worry about it. Just, I'll get you in the podcast. And thank you to Paddy, most importantly, for being just such a gracious and generous and open and honest guest and a brilliant friend. So there it is. Do get in touch if you want to suggest guests for future live events. The next one, as I said at the start of the show, is on Thursday, the 25th of August. Again, at the West Hampstead Arts Club. My guest for that one is Thomas Nicholas, who is an actor, producer, and musician, best known probably as Kevin Myers in American Pie. But he's been in tons of films. He's got lots of albums out as well. So, yeah, he's going to perform some live tracks. We'll ask him about his movie and music career, and you can ask him your questions.